got there all at 6. We tried to do our best. Welcome all. I'll later call Priyaji, who is one of our core volunteers, who will officially welcome Atishi and everyone here. From what I understand, there are a few people who have come here for the first time. I'll quickly go over what we are going to do here today. We will welcome Atishi, and Atishi will be walking us over the Delhi education work that has happened in Delhi by AAP government. That should last about 40 to 45 minutes, half an hour. And then we'll open the floor for questions. You can ask questions on education, healthcare, politics, anything that you like. After that, 7:30, we are going to serve dinner. And Atishi can walk around in the room and you can talk to her. People who have come here for the first time, feel free to come to some of us. My name is Rahul. I take care of the social media team. We have Gaurav here. He takes care of the fundraising. Harpreet? Where's Harpreet? Harpreet? If you can show yourself to the audience, he is our AAP UK convener. So he's our boss here. He manages all our teams. We have Akhilda here. He is one of the senior volunteers we have. We have Priyaji. We have Vikram Bhai here, who is our technology lead. He takes care of all the tech stuff. So I'll invite Priyaji now to officially welcome Atishi here. Thank you.
Very pleasant today, and we have a warm evening. And I'm so glad to see you all here. We have Atishi Marlena, advisor on education to the Delhi government's deputy chief minister, Manish Sisodia, with us here in London. She's here in UK for this week on a 3-day visit to UK. It started yesterday that she spoke at the London School of Economics. Today she is with us. We're really excited to have her with us, and tomorrow she will be presenting a talk in Oxford. We all know about her, but a little bit before ending up. She has been very instrumental in the education reforms that happens in Delhi. Education is a powerful tool that can change the world, are the words of Nelson Mandela. And a reform, a revolution that happens in education is very crucial, and that too in the national capital of India. The education reforms that she and her team has done has touched many lives of children, parents, and teachers themselves. Within 3 years of governance, the education reforms that has been done in Delhi's state government has reached globally, the news has reached globally. There has been many accolades and appreciation for the work that Atishi and her team has done in Delhi. She's going to elaborate on this today, and I'm sure you have many queries as well as words of appreciation for her. At the end of her presentation, please, as Rahul said, please feel free to have an interactive discussion. And I hope you have a very fruitful and an interactive discussion today. I invite Akhil to hand over the bouquet to Atishi. Sorry. Thank you, Akhil. Without taking much of your time, let me request Atishi Marlena on stage, please. Please give her a grand round of applause. We're so excited and looking forward for the presentation. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. And it's a pleasure to be here. the Aadmi Party UK unit, because while working in Delhi, working in India in Aadmi Party, I think one is working with a very large community of people who want to bring some change. To be so far away from Delhi, to be so far away from India, and yet to carry on that spirit is remarkable. So it's great to see all of you, and I'm sure that we'll have a longer discussion about this. Today, a lot of the focus of my talk is going to be regarding many of the changes that we have brought about in the education system in Delhi, especially in the government schools in Delhi. And I'll be talking about why is it that we have been able to do this. And I think the reason I want to share that with all of you is that all of you are Indians who are living abroad, concerned about what is happening to the country. Many of you are Aadmi Party volunteers who have put in a lot of effort and time and committed a lot of your lives to Aadmi Party. So the question might also sometimes arise in your minds, is it worth all the effort that we do? Is it worth it when we make all these calls, when we raise all that funds? So today we are, hopefully I shall try and address some of those questions. Next. So look at this picture. Can anyone tell me what this is? It's Manish Sisodia's house, yes. So you see a blue, Manish Sisodia is the Deputy Chief Minister of Delhi, for those of you who don't know. There's a blue notice, and there's this white paper you see over there. It's a small notice outside the Deputy Chief Minister's residence. Can anyone guess what might be written on that?
No bribes.
No bribes. Anything else?
Gifts. No gifts.
No gifts. Any other guesses?
Right to meet with everyone.
Can someone read this out? What does this say? For those of you who read Hindi.
Private schoolों की मनमानी के खिलाफ हमारी सरकार कोर्ट में गई है. अतः आपसे निवेदन है कि private schoolों में प्रवेश कराने की सिफारिश हेतु हम पर दबाव ना बनाएं, इससे हमारी ये मुहिम कमजोर हो सकती है. धन्यवाद, मनीष सिसोदिया.
So what this says outside the door of the education minister and the deputy chief minister is that right now is the admission season going on. So everyone is looking to get their children admitted in nursery. Any of you who are from Delhi know that nursery admission season is one of the most crazy things that exists in the world. You have people queuing up all night to get their children admitted in schools. And this is the time when people use all their political connections, all the money they have, to get their children admitted into the schools that will sort of set them on the path for the future. And a lot of money changes hands, and a lot of political influence changes hands. And outside the door of the education minister, it says that our government has gone to court against private schools for the irregularities they do. So please do not come to us with any sifarish, with any recommendations to get your children admitted there. Because the minute we get into this cycle of sifarish or recommendations, of irregular recommendations to these private schools, we will never be able to take action against them. And this is what it says outside his door. And what we need to understand is why this notice is such a big deal. And not just in Delhi, but across the country, for the past 20 years, government schools, can you see the PPT? Or is it? So the reason why this notice is important is because in the last 20 years, in the last 20, 30 years, government schools have become extremely poor quality throughout the country. And the reason for that one needs to understand is that the very people who are in charge of improving the government schools, which is your politicians, which is your governments, have actually had a lot of vested interest in private schools. I often say that there should be some kind of research on this fact that when you have a city like Delhi, you have a master plan with the DDMA. So there's some pieces of land that are allocated for schools. And a lot of the prime property that is allocated for schools has actually been given to private schools at extremely low rates. So it would be worth researching the fact that in what year, what government was in power, and who are the schools who actually got land during that time, because we'll find out that a lot of politicians actually have interests in different school chains, number one. If you see the management committees of a lot of private schools, you often have retired bureaucrats on those committees. So the very people who were supposed to improve the government school system actually had an interest in the private school system.
And as a consequence, we go on to the next slide. As a consequence, you almost have a systematic neglect of government schools. And while private schools have been able to provide high quality education to some people, and I think that many of the people who are sitting in this room today have probably studied in high quality private schools in the country. What we need to realize is that private schools can only provide for some people. Private schools can never provide for all people. And if we are looking for India to become a developed country, if we are looking for India to really go into the 21st century, it is finally the responsibility of the government to provide high quality education to every child, irrespective of their ability to pay. Because otherwise what happens is that when we talk about economic policies and economic growth, we say that you should get investment, you should give tax breaks, you should have special economic zones and different kinds of policies. But if your population is not educated or does not have the skills to actually make use of those policies, there is no point to any of that. And this is the reason why that the Aam Aadmi Party government has decided to focus on education and health as two of its most significant agendas. And so that is why the story that has started of what is the kind of transformation that we are trying to bring in Delhi education. So I was involved quite a lot in making the manifesto of the party, both in 2013 and in 2015. So we were very clear that we want to improve the education system, and we wrote these nice paragraphs in the manifesto that we'd make government schools as good as private schools, and we are going to transform education. But the reality is that when we were writing all those nice things in the manifesto, we had no idea how we were actually going to do it. And when we came into power in February 2015, and I have lived in Delhi all of my life. I've done my schooling in Delhi, I've done my undergrad degree in Delhi. But I had never been to a government school, I had never actually stepped inside a government school. And when we actually for the first time started going into government schools, we realized that actually the state of government schools is much worse than what we had expected. And I often say this to a lot of people, and whenever I talk on education, when for the first time I stepped into a government school, it was in South Delhi area, a place called Tughlaqabad. And when we entered the school, the first thing that you noticed was the smell of the toilet. You could smell the toilet till the gate of the school. So forget about quality education, making them as good as private schools, providing access. We could not even keep our schools clean. So you have a toilet that you can smell till the gate, and there's actually students sitting in the corridor right outside that place where the toilet is smelling. And that was the reality of government schools, that they were not clean, that windows were broken, that fans were broken, there were not enough classrooms, often teachers were not going into class. So the situation in many ways was much worse than what we had even thought of. And then we thought that, as I said, we didn't know how we were going to change things, so we decided let's take a step-by-step approach. And one of the first things that we felt that needed to be changed was actually upgrading the infrastructure. Now you can say that there are infrastructure does not lead to quality education. But till some of the basic infrastructure was in place, one really couldn't start talking about high quality education before you actually started cleaning the toilets. And not just that, the second thing about government schools was, and I think that this is true of all government construction, is that whether the government departments were constructing schools, whether they were constructing slum resettlement colonies, whether they were constructing government offices, all the construction looked exactly the same. And often these government school buildings were horrible and depressing places. And from the time a child entered a government school, so you see broken windows, you see a shabbily kept school, you see a dirty school. From that time, that child knows that I'm a second class citizen. That for me are these shabby, broken down schools, and for the kids who are going to make it in the world, unke liye wo chamakte hue schools hain. For them, you have all these fancy schools with nice buildings. So from that time, it's very clear that I'm not going to get anywhere. It's only these children who go to these English medium private schools who are going to make it in the world. So we decided that we are going to upgrade the infrastructure, improve the quality of the infrastructure, and make the infrastructure as good or even better than what a lot of the private schools have. And so these are some pictures that we have of what government schools used to look like. Can you see the picture? Thanks. So this is what an average classroom used to look like 3 years ago. This is what a corridor looked like, a bathroom. And now, as I said, this is something that we chose consciously, that we are actually going to give every school that we are building, every school that we are renovating, a high quality look. This is what a classroom looks like now. This is one of the new classrooms. These are again classrooms, libraries, toilets. I often talk a lot about toilets when we are discussing the change in education. And we have upgraded sports facilities. These are some of the new classrooms, revamped auditoriums. These are the labs. Again. In fact, interestingly, sometimes when we post a lot of these pictures on social media, many of our opponents, one day I tweeted this picture of one of our schools in Lajpat Nagar in Delhi. And some of our opponents actually said, this is a fake picture. This is not a picture of a school in Delhi. This is a picture of a school in Singapore. And so we said that you are actually validating what good work we are doing. And one of our volunteers went to Lajpat Nagar and took a video from outside the road in Lajpat Nagar to show that actually this did belong to a school in Delhi. Now, how did a lot of this change happen? Now, the thing is that I actually have a degree. I have a master's degree in education. But the interesting thing is that in the past 3 years that we have been working on education, frankly, I've never needed to use it. Most of the things that we have been doing are very common sense things that anyone could have thought of. The real challenge has been in the actual implementation of it. For example, and I said I often talk a lot about toilets, is that when I first went into a government school, the smell of the toilet showed the fact that nobody cared about the children who were studying in that school. I mean, there were girls in those schools who would say that we actually don't even use the toilets in the school. We wait till we go back home because the toilets are so dirty. And we really spent, I think, the first year of our term just making sure schools were clean. And I used to sometimes joke with Manishji, the education minister, that I think that I work in the sanitation department, not in the education department, because the level of details that we had to go to make sure that schools are clean. So we decided that we needed a new sanitation contractor. So when we were going to make the new contract, even down to the details of how many bottles of phenyl do you need every week to make sure toilets are clean, how many bottles of Harpic do you need, how many brushes do you need, how many machines do you need, how many sanitation workers do you need for every year, depending upon the size of the school. And we would go on school inspections, and the first thing that we would always be saying is, the school clean? Is the corridor clean? Are there any cobwebs? And the funny thing is, and I have some of my relatives in the audience also, the funny thing is that, as some of them might tell you, is that I have never been a very freak for cleanliness myself. And now, however, when I enter into a school building, the first thing that I'm looking for, are there any specks of dirt here? Are there any cobwebs on the corridor? Are the fans clean? Are the windows clean? Not just this, we made sure that all officers in the government, the minister himself, everyone went, we all went for regular inspections. And I'll talk about school management committees in a little while, but we also got a lot of the community involved in making sure that schools are clean. And I think I find it a great source of personal achievement that after about a year or so of when we came into the government, the toilets in government schools now only smell of phenomic and of nothing else. But this was an indicator, the fact that of wanting to keep schools clean was an indicator of the fact that now when children come into schools, when their classrooms, we could go back to the previous slide, when their classrooms actually look like this, their desks are, you have proper furniture there, their walls are whitewashed, schools are clean. The message is very clear, not just to the students, but also to the teachers, that this place is a serious establishment, that this is a serious institution where proper education needs to happen. So that was number one, that was one of our main areas of focus. Now, anyone who has lived in India for a while knows that getting any work done out of any government department is not easy. And not just in schools, but one of the major problems across all government departments is a lack of accountability. And the reason this lack of accountability exists, and once you get a government job, now irrespective of how you perform in the job,
irrespective of whether you work, irrespective of whether you don't work, on the first of every month you get your salary. And I also sometimes think that if I was a government school teacher, and whether I went to school, or whether I did not go to school, or whether I, once I leave school, whether I taught or I did not teach, irrespective of that, if I was to get my salary, then over time we would also become like that. We would all think, what's the point of working if I'm going to get paid anyway, whether I work or I don't. So one of our big challenges was increasing the accountability of the system. And increasing accountability is not easy because it's a big system. Like, you have more than 1,000 schools. Now, with 1,000 schools, you have one minister. Even if he starts going on school inspections every day, it'll take him 2-3 years before he can go to every school. Similarly, even if you look at your officers in the education department, so at the district level, you have deputy directors of education. On an average, each deputy director has about 100 to 150 schools in their area. Even if you assume that the officer is extremely hardworking and extremely honest, which they are often not, even if you assume all of that and you see that they go regularly to schools, go for school inspections, it will be at least 1 or 2 months before they can go back to every school. So obviously, this centralization meant that there was no regular accountability of the schools. So one of the things that we did, and I personally believe this has played a major role in changing our schools, is that we got the community involved. So every school has something called a school management committee. Under the Right to Education Act, every school is supposed to have a management committee which consists of 75% parents. So you have a 16-member committee which consists of 12 parents. But when you look at government schools, when you think of parents who are sending their children to government schools, there is often a big class divide between the people who are teaching in government schools and between the people whose children are studying in government schools. So you have, I think that a government school principal would probably be getting a salary of around 1 lakh rupees per month. And the children who are coming in are often children who are first generation school goers. They are parents who might actually be daily wage earners, who might be drivers, who might be construction workers, who might be vegetable workers. So you have a huge class divide. And these parents are actually afraid of even entering the school premises. By the time you reach the school, the security guard can sort of insult you and turn you away. Why are you here? You can't go here. So getting this community involved was in itself quite challenging. But we found that once our school management committees became active, and I have some pictures here which we can see. These are basically, you see this line of people who are standing there. So we decided that we are going to make these school management committees active, and we were going to have elections for school management committees since they were supposed to be democratically elected bodies. And everyone used to say, especially all the bureaucrats, that ye toh koi interested nahi hai, koi nahi aane wala, they are not going to participate. But our experience was, you see this line of people, these were people who actually came to vote in the school management committee elections. So when you gave people an option of participating and being involved in their schools, because everyone felt ki hum chahte hain ki hamare bacche ka school achha ho. So people actually came forward, people participated. And with these school management committee members, there's lots of, once we gave people power at the local level to actually help manage their schools, they came up with solutions that we could never have come up with. So one example, that one problem that we often used to have is that in Delhi, a lot of schools run in 2 shifts. So in the morning, because of a shortage of space, so in the morning you have a girls' school, and in the second shift you have a boys' school. Now in the second shift, especially in outer Delhi, you have a lot of teachers who are coming from outside Delhi. They could be coming from Meerut, they could be coming from Faridabad, they could be coming from Palwal. So what used to happen is that the timing of the school was effectively determined by the timing of the trains to and from the railway station. So if the train to Meerut left at 5 o'clock, the whole school would be empty at 4:30, even though the school hours went on till 6 p.m. So there was one such case that happened in East Delhi near the Anand Vihar railway station. There's one school in Shahadra. And there used to be a train at 5 o'clock to Meerut, and all teachers were gone from the school at 4:30. Now if all teachers are gone, obviously no students are going to stay. The teachers chale gaye to bacche kya karenge wahan pe.
So the SNC members decided that they needed to do something about it. So they set up a duty timetable between themselves, and every day, two SNC members would go and sit in the room of the security guard, and they would lock the door from the inside. And they would just lock the door and they would stay there for 4 hours. Which meant that neither the students nor the teachers could actually leave the school. So the school, they thought that, initially the teachers thought, chalo, they'll do it for a week, they'll do it for 2 weeks. But they did it for over a month and a half. So eventually the teachers also gave up their fight and they also just started staying on for longer work, for their working hours. Similarly, another SMC member had shared this story with me. There's a lot of unauthorized colonies in Delhi, whoever has been to Delhi, and you often have these thin, narrow buildings, which are often to the third, fourth, fifth floor. So one SMC member, her son used to study in the school, and she was not very educated herself. But she said that, you know, when I'm working in my house in the morning, so when I'm cleaning the house, from my balcony, I can see the school. So when I'm working in the house, I'd be cleaning my house, then I'd step out to the balcony and see school time se shuru ho gaya ki nahi ho gaya. Has the school started on time or not? Have the children come on time or not? She said, then I'll go back to my work, and then sometime I'll come back and check once again, has the school assembly started? Or maybe later in the day I'll go and check once whether all the children are in their class. And she said that if I saw, maine agar dekha ki kuch gadbad hai, to main apne ghar se niche utar ke school mein chali jati thi. So very ordinary people actually came forward to participate in improving their schools. You would almost think that what could an uneducated woman do to make sure that the school was running okay? But for the first time, there were people who cared enough to improve schools. So they would regularly visit the schools. They would ask, "Bhai, yahan pe safai kyun nahi hui? Yahan pe safai kyun nahi hui?" And that really helped improve the things on the ground. So ordinary people, children, parents of children who were studying in government schools, people who were often not educated themselves, they have all contributed in actually improving the school system. A second thing that we did that has really helped was we organized for the first time parent-teacher meetings. Now parent-teacher meetings, one can think, hey, what's the big deal? Like, it's a very normal thing, it happens in all schools. But in India, parent-teacher meetings would never happen in government schools. Now, for the first time in these parent-teacher meetings, the doors of government schools were opened for the parents. And before that, you know, when we first came into the government, there was a class divide in our schools, that you had the teachers and principals coming from one background, your children coming from another background. And there would be a lot of negative perception about parents. So teachers would tell us, "Ji, in bachchon ke to parents ka koi padhai wadhai mein interest hi nahi hai. Ye to kabhi school nahi aate. Ye to sirf us din hi school aate hain jis din scholarship badhti hai." That the parents of these children are not interested in the education of their children. That they will come to school only on the day that the scholarships are distributed and they can take the money home. And we decided that it's very important to have the parents participate in the child's education. So we organized a mega PTM where we had a parent-teacher meeting on the same day in all schools across the city. And we did a lot of advertising for it. We ran a campaign on radio. We got an advertisement in the newspaper. We got children to make handmade cards to give to their parents. And I think the first PTM was last year in July. And all the teachers and all the officers were saying to us, no one is going to turn up. You don't get your hopes too high. These parents are not going to come. And kaise na kaise, bad luck bhi kharab tha hamara, that on the day of the first PTM, it started raining, and it started raining very heavily. And so we were all very worried, okay, now no one is actually going to turn up. And next slide. This is the sort of attendance that we had. That not just a few people, but parents came out in very large numbers. And 80-90% of the parents, this is not an SMC lecture, this is actually parents queuing up to go to the school for the parent-teacher meeting. And despite the fact that it was a very heavy rainy day, 80-90% of the parents turned up because they felt that they want to know what is going on in their children's schools. And I think this for the first time meant that the divide between the teachers and the parents was broken down. And there was one teacher whom we met when we had gone for one of these parent-teacher meetings, and she was speaking to one parent, and when they left, she had tears in her eyes. So we asked her what the matter was, and she said, you know, I always used to think that these parents are not interested in their children's education. But today when I met the parent for the first time, I found out that his father does two jobs just to make sure that he can get food on the table for his child. That he wakes up at 5 o'clock in the morning and he cleans cars in the locality. And then after that, from 8 o'clock in the morning to 8 o'clock at night, he's a vegetable vendor. So he says it's a very big deal that he is just sending. The fact that he's sending his child to the school is such a big deal that it's now I don't feel that it's their responsibility. Now I feel it's my responsibility to make sure that this child does well. So when we opened the gates of the schools to parents, I think that for the first time, a relationship of trust began to build between teachers and parents. And I think it made a lot of difference even to the mindset of teachers when they were teaching in the schools. Yeah. So this is for example a photograph of an SMC meeting going on. And the reason I find these photographs very interesting is you can see that lady is sitting there with her head covered. So it's possible that this lady never steps out of her house otherwise. It's possible that she is uneducated herself. But because she feels that the school needs to be improved, she's coming regularly for the meetings and making sure that things go well. Once some of these basic things were fixed, we actually started working towards improving the core of education in terms of the quality of education. And one problem that existed was that the level of the children's education was much lower than what it should have been. Now, anyone who's familiar with education in India knows that every year in January, this organization called Pratham releases something called the Asar Report. And every year, the Asar Report says that half the children in the country don't even know how to read and write. And so this is not a new fact that children in India don't know how to read and write. But the fact is that no governments have ever really done anything about it. Once we started our work on actually bridging this learning gap, we brought this policy that just because a child is in class 6 and doesn't know how to read, what's the point of doing syllabus? So we actually divided the children by level rather than by their class. So the children who did not know how to read, we started working on that. Or children who were at their grade level, we started teaching them at grade level. Again, we had a lot of community involvement. We started running something called reading melas, which would run in schools on weekends where sort of people from the community participated to ensure that they could help children how to read. So these are some sort of innovative things that teachers started doing. We had a lot of teachers training that how is it that when children are at different levels or children don't know how to read and write, how do you improve their education? Sort of a lot of fun-based activities we started doing in summer camps for children. Yeah. Then there was a lot of investment that we started making in teachers' training. And for the first time, interestingly, IAS officers or bureaucrats would often go abroad for training. That IAS officers would go for a degree in public policy to Princeton, they would be sent off on government money. We decided that we are actually going to send our teachers and our principals for the best world-class training. And the interesting thing is that we actually faced resistance from a lot of our bureaucrats. And one question that we asked them is, they said that many of them said that it's a waste of government money. Why do we want to send them abroad? We can train them here itself. And one of the questions we asked them is it not a waste of government money when you are sent abroad for your trainings? Why is it that it's okay to send an IAS officer, but why is it not okay to send a teacher? Why is it not okay to send a principal? So this photograph, let me just go back. This photograph is when some of our teachers had gone to the National Institute of Education, Singapore, for their training. We have been sending all our principals of all 1,000 principals of our schools are undergoing training in IIM Ahmedabad. And as a consequence of that, you have a lot of now innovative teaching methods, etc. That So what are our key takeaways from this? That after 3 years of bringing a lot of changes in the education system, I think one of our key takeaways is that policy making is not rocket science. It is not difficult to do all of these things. It is not difficult to improve government schools. It's not difficult to improve our healthcare systems. The real challenge lies in some ways in implementation. So a lot of the things we have done, they were not very fancy policy ideas. For example, getting schools clean is a very common sense thing. It does not take a lot of effort to know, does not take a lot of, one does not have to be a genius to think that schools have to be clean, that teachers have to be in the classroom, that regular classes have to happen. And yet, none of this has ever happened before. Now the question arises that, why has this never happened? And I think that at the end of 3 years, I have a very simple answer for this. None of this has ever happened before because nobody has cared enough to do it. I don't think that there is any other more sophisticated, more complicated reason than this. The reason no government schools have not improved, the reason government hospitals have not improved, the reason why every home does not have drinking water, the reason why there is no high quality public transport is because no one has bothered to do it. What you basically had are governments that come into power and have their own nexuses with vested interests. So for example, in the field of education, you would have an education minister who's very closely connected to private school lobbies, who's on one phone call who can get children admitted into the most expensive schools, whose interest lies in the fact that where are the textbooks going to get published so that they can get their cut on the textbooks? Where are the uniforms going to be made where you're going to get a cut? And it's because nobody has cared that things are so bad. And once governments actually start functioning, once you have, when we are fighting elections, we talk a lot of times about quote unquote honest governance. This is honest governance. And it is because of this honest governance that change is possible. And none of this change involves, as I said, none of this change I think involves rocket science. And if volunteers. This is the reason why we actually need to. This is the reason why all of us actually need to engage in politics. This is the reason why that despite against all odds, we need to continue this fight, because finally change is going to come from politics. At the talk yesterday, I was sharing this incident that when we were discussing politics, someone had used the phrase that politics is like the gutter. But the problem is that this gutter is where the most important decisions that affect our lives are getting made. So if we want to have better lives, we will have to get into the gutter to actually clean the gutter. And unless we are willing to do that, things are not going to change. And I think that the interesting thing that 3 years of AAP as a political party, 5 years of AAP as a political party and 3 years of AAP as a government have shown, number one, that change is possible. That when you have honest intent and creative solutions, change is possible. Number two, change is not going to come only from politicians or bureaucrats themselves. Change is going to come when ordinary people get involved. So as I said, it took sort of very simple, often not very educated, ordinary citizens to actually improve the things on the ground that no minister or no bureaucrat would actually have done. Number three, and I think this is our biggest challenge, that we have to change the political discourse to real issues. Right now, a lot of the political discourse in our country is around caste, it's around religion, it's at the time of elections about money and liquor and giving up things. I think that we have to get issues like education, like healthcare, like public transport, to the very center of our political discourse. And I've actually used this phrase, citizenship politics. That politics has to be beyond just caste or community. Politics has to be about the rights of citizens. It is the right of every citizen to have high quality education. It is the right of every citizen to have high quality healthcare. It's the right of every citizen to have a running water connection in their house. It's the right of every citizen to have access to high quality public transport. And I think this is what Aam Aadmi Party is bringing into politics, that we will talk about real issues and we will actually get ordinary people involved in this process of change. So I'll end at that. And any questions that you may have? And this is, as I said, again a picture from one of our parent-teacher meetings and our SLC meetings, that it's these people who have brought the change. I don't think we have brought the change. I think we have just created an opportunity where a lot of people can ask questions and bring about the transformation system.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot, Atishi. It was a wonderful session. So, yes, so let's have a round of.
Thank you, Atishi, for taking us through the journey of how AAP is transforming government schools to such a great standard. My question is, after doing so many things in the government school, I have read an article on news saying that the pre-board exams or results of pre-board exams of class 10 was below expectations, or I would say it's bad. Do you have any specific reason why the result is so bad after doing so many things? Because I understand it cannot be changed overnight, but yes. But still, the results are very bad. So, your thoughts on that, please.
See, when one is looking at changes in the education system, I think that there's most of us who are sitting here in this room are not products of the government school system. And if you were to look at the state of government schools, like some of those pictures that I had shared with you at the beginning, if we cannot even keep our schools clean, how is it, what is the level of education that we would have been giving in our schools? So children who have been in government schools for a very extended period of time have actually got extremely low learning levels. I don't know if you saw, there was one figure in the slide. 2 years ago, we did an assessment of all the students in class 6, 7, and 8. And we found that 74% children who were studying in class 6 could not even read their own textbook. So if a child cannot read their own textbook, how are they ever going to learn anything? The second thing is that over the past few years, we've had something called the No Detention Policy as part of the Right to Education Act. The fact that no child will get detained in their previous class, even if they are not up to their class-appropriate learning outcomes. This was intended as a very good policy, that there should not be stress caused by exams, etc. But what this has meant is that even if a child does not know anything, they keep getting passed year after year after year. And this policy extends up to class 8. So for the first time, children face exams in class 9. And there are a lot of children who are even in grade 9 who don't know how to read and write. So these are children who have been in the school system for all of these years, but don't even know the basics. And that is why we actually had to run something like a reading campaign. Why do you need a reading campaign for children who are in class 6 or 7? It's because if a child has not learned how to read, how are they going to be able to do anything else? So even though we have brought in a lot of change, I think we need to understand that something like education reform is at least a 10-year project. So, like, I'll share with you these figures that when, in 2015, when our government was formed, we were looking at some data about how many children passed class 10, a cohort, how many children passed class 10, and how many of those children actually passed class 12 also, if you follow a cohort. So for the batch that was in class 12, who were giving their board exams in 2015, there was a 48% gap between the children who passed class 10, 48% less children passed out of class 12. So they dropped out somewhere in between. Within 1 year of our government, so that means children who were in class 12 who had been in schools when we had been in power for 1 year, that figure reduced from 48% dropout to about 30%. So the gap between those who passed class 10 and 12 was 30%. Year 3, when the children had studied in school under 2 years of our government in class 11 and 12, that gap dropped to only 18%. So that means that once children actually got higher quality education, the chances of their passing their class 12 board exam went up substantially. But as I said, this is change that is going to take a long time. This is not going to, this change is not going to happen overnight.
Thanks, Abhishek.
Hi, Atishi. This is all amazing to my ear, but I'll pay it level 7 okay. So it looks like that we are focusing on government school, and also are we against private school, because I have not gone, none of my relatives go to private or two government schools. So a lot of society, it seems the impression I get is that we are against private school. That is probably a wrong impression. Second thing is, do we have a scheme like grammar school, what we have in UK, where good students are promoted to some kind of, you know, those schools? Third question is about security of the students. If we saw about Ryan's school, a lot of issues. So CCTVs or anything is planned to improve the security.
First of all, we are not against any private school, but I think what we need to understand is that private schools are not a solution for everyone. That are we going to only provide high quality education to people who can afford to pay high fees? So as I said, that private schools are a solution as of now also for only 5% of people. But no country has ever developed without providing high quality education to everyone. After all, if you do want your economy to grow, and who is going to be doing the jobs, who is going to have the skills to actually make the economy grow? And so our focus on as a government has been on improving government schools. A lot of the private schools are doing a good job as it is. So I think that the best we can do is not intervene. But one of the problems in private schools has been that for anyone who knows Delhi's situation, private schools keep increasing their fees year after year after year. Why are they able to do that? They are able to do that because they know that people have no choice. Tomorrow, if government schools improve and people get high quality education free of cost, why would you want to pay a lot of money for high quality education? So even in terms of regulating private schools, the answer is actually in improving government schools. Second, about your question regarding security, we are in the process of putting CCTV cameras in our schools.
Grammar schools.
So we have something called RPVVs, Rajkiya Pratibha Vikas Vidyalayas, where students can take an entrance exam and get admission. But I think that I'm personally not necessarily in favor of better schools for some children and average schools for everyone else. I think we have to work to make sure that everyone gets high quality education.
Atishi, very inspiring work. Very simple question is, compared to the sort of two big national parties and some of the other more established local parties, Aadmi Party is quite a young party. So the question is, what is the plan to keep continuing the sort of ethical governance model that we have, and how do you make sure that we get the right people in and flush them also, right people, I guess, out? So the question is around sustainability and making sure that we stay true to the course, essentially, and what is the strategy around that?
So see, on the ethical governance model, first of all, it's not, ours is not the Napoleonic model that we are going to win all the states and we are going to, once Aadmi Party government is installed in all the states, we have ethical governance everywhere. I think the intention is also to prove that good governance is also good politics. So which is why I think we face a big challenge in 2020 when we go back for elections in Delhi. If after doing this work in education, in healthcare, water, electricity, etc., if after that we are going to get re-elected, then other parties will also have to follow that model, because it will show that good governance is good politics. But if we don't succeed, for example, and if we were to do all this work on health and education and still lose an election, then I think the message to all other political parties would be that ji, aaye the ye log badi badi baatein karte the ki humne school badal diye, hospital badal diye, kisi ne unhe vote nahi diya. So I think that the real test lies in this process of change, because it's not just by the fact that Aam Aadmi Party is going to win more and more states. I think that we have to show that all politics needs to be done like this.
Atishi, good evening. Welcome in England. My question you already covered. What I want to know, in England, up to the age of 16, we got a free education, doesn't matter the cost, color, grade, whatever it is. And then is that free education for everybody in the government school, or was there a fees in the world? So,
sorry?
Any fees in the world in the school, private government school?
There's no fees. There's no fees in government
schools. And the second, my question is that because of sustainability in the future, we have done hard work, people doing hard work to lift the school and everything else. But what will happen after 2020 when the election comes? In case of didn't come back.
I mean,
so the hard work done, the spending money might be
more
people.
End of our
event
today.
Just not even
today.
Sure that it does come back.
Thank you.
We're about to end live.
I have an attachment to a better India. And that is
we had a very successful event today with Atishi walking us through Delhi education and Delhi government initiatives.
All of us should work for that better solution. But right now, I think our biggest challenge is
we will end the live now. Thank you all for connecting.
That
we end the live. Thank you all for joining.